Hi, good morning to everyone. In previous week, we complete the concept of waves. So in this present week, I started a new lesson known as wave optics. Generally, Optics means it is a concept which discuss the interactive properties of light. Interactive properties of light means, in general, light has some particular characteristics called as rectilinear propagation of light. First one is rectilinear propagation of light. Second one, law of reflection. Third one, the law of refraction. Fourth one, interference. Fifth one, diffraction. And sixth one is polarization. These are the main properties of light. First one, rectilinear propagation of light means straight line propagation is also called as rectilinear propagation. Reflection of light, refraction of light, interference, diffraction and polarization. But rectilinear propagation of light and also reflection as well as refraction, these three properties of light can be explained in geometrical optics. First concept is geometrical optics. Second one, interference of light, diffraction and polarization. Interference, diffraction and polarization. These three concepts are explained in wave optics. So, the study of geometrical optics. Geometrical optics can be discussed laterally. In the next concept. In present, I will discuss the concept about the interference, diffraction and also polarization, right? So in this wave optics, first before we introduce the interference, diffraction and polarization, first we should know very well how the waves, light is traveling in the form of waves and what are the theories of light. The first theory is, theory means what is the characteristic nature of the light. To explain the characteristic nature of the light, we are having mainly four theories. Andhlo first one chesi Newton corpuscles theory. Newton corpuscular theory. Second one, Huygens wave theory. These three are very important in this concept. What are the first two? Newton corpuscular theory and Huygens wave theory. So the first concept is Newton corpuscular theory of light. According to Newton corpuscular theory, the scientist Newton assumed that every light source emits tiny particles called corpuscles of light, and these tiny particles have elastic, rigid and massless different shaped particles. Means, suppose it is a point source. S is a point source like a light, tube light, or like a torch light. The source will emit the light in forward direction. Light is going along this direction. Newton assumed that light is emitted from the source only in the form of small particles which are assumed to be corpuscles. Corpuscle means it is a small particle which is having elastic nature, rigid, massless, different shape and size. So that means every particle, it is completely elastic in nature, highly rigid one, as well as massless, mass of the particle is very less. And also, all these corpuscles or particles, they have different shape and size. So, the first assumption is, every source can emit a light in the form of tiny particles which are called as the corpuscles. Second point is, these particles will travel always in straight line with different speeds in different medias. These corpuscles will follow the straight line path always, and the speed of these particles will be different in different media. Means, by changing the medium, velocity of the particle should also changes. The straight line propagation of these particles is also known as the rectilinear propagation. Next, the third one. Suppose we know WIBGR and a white light. White is not a single color. It consists of 7 colors coming from violet to red. Violet wavelength is approximately equal to 4000 angstrom units. Red color is wavelength is equal to 7000 angstrom units. Violet to red. Ikkada manaki all the particles which are emitted from the source will have different shape and size. So, suppose all these particles having one size, they forms the violet color, and other size, they forms the indigo, and remaining sized particles will forms different colors. That means color of the light is mainly due to variation of sizes of the corpuscles. Suppose for the same size in particles, they forms one color. In that way, all these particles, they have different size kabatti, the color of the light is mainly by the different sizes of the corpuscles. Also, Newton assumed that velocity of light in denser medium is greater than the velocity of the light in rarer medium. Velocity of the light in denser medium is more than the velocity of light in rarer medium. These are the main assumptions according to Newton's corpuscles theory. But this theory can fails. There are called as the limitations. This theory can fails to explain interference of light, second one, diffraction of light, and third one, polarization of light. Why? Because interference is nothing but the superposition of two light waves. Means, suppose this is a wave, one wave, and this is the another wave. These two waves are superimposed together to produce interference. But as according to Newton's theory, light is emitted from the source only in the form of particles, small particles, not waves. That's why Newton theory cannot explain the concept of interference. Similarly, diffraction. Diffraction means it is a bending of light at the edges of the obstacle. Bending of light wave. So, diffraction is also a concept about the wave nature. That's why this cannot be explained Newton's corpuscles theory. Polarization also explains the transverse nature of light. Transverse nature of light wave. That means these three properties of light can be explained according to wave theory. But Newton theory prakaram, light is always emitted in the form of corpuscles. That's why this theory cannot explain these three properties of light. But Newton theory can explain the concept of first one, rectilinear propagation of light, second one, reflection of light, reflection, and third one, refraction of light. So these three properties of light can be successfully explained according to Newton theory, but interference, diffraction, and polarization, they cannot explain the Newton's theory of light. That means there are some limitations according to Newton's corpuscles theory. So later, the scientist Huygens introduced a theory which is known as the Huygens wave theory. According to Huygens' theory, he assumed that light is propagated through a medium in the form of mechanical waves. Light is emitted in the form of mechanical waves. You know, in waves. We learn about the types of waves. Generally, waves are of two types: mechanical waves as well as non-mechanical waves. Mechanical waves means a wave which requires a medium for its propagation, then the wave is said to be a mechanical wave. So according to Huygens theory, first assumption of Huygens theory is light is emitted from source to another point only in the form of mechanical wave, means light has compulsory a material medium for its propagation. Say for example, this is the sun and this is earth. Suppose here the light is coming from the source to earth. Source to earth in the form of mechanical waves. According to Huygens theory, this is emitted in the form of mechanical waves. Mechanical wave means compulsory, one material medium is compulsory between source and observer. But here there is a large empty space between sun and earth. That's why light is not a mechanical wave. But he strongly believed that light is transmitted or propagated in the form of mechanical waves. So he also assumed that in between sun and earth, or in between sun and any planet, there should be a medium which is assumed by the scientist Huygens, which is called as the ether. Ether. So ether is a medium which is pervading in the universe completely. And what are the properties of ether? Ether medium, which is highly elastic, which is highly elastic and also less density. Density of ether is also very less. That means empty space, the sun and earth, in between sun and earth, the total space is not completely vacuum. This space is completely filled with ether medium according to Huygens theory. Ether is a medium, hypothetical medium, which is having highly elastic nature as well as less density. So again, velocity of the mechanical wave, you know, v is equal to square root of e by d, e by rho, where e is equal to elasticity or modulus of velocity, and rho is equal to density of the medium. In case of ether, e, capital E, is highly elastic, means it is very 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 high, and density, less light, less density, means rho is very less. Capital E is very high and rho is very less. That's why speed of the light depends on elastic nature as well as the density of the given medium. Also, Huygens assumed that the velocity of light in the rarer medium is greater than velocity of light in denser medium. And the velocity of light in rarer medium is more than velocity of denser medium. In case of rarer medium, density will be very less. Density less means velocity will be more. In case of denser medium, density will be more and velocity of light is minimum. So that's why, according to Huygens theory, velocity of the light is more in rarer medium and compared with the denser medium, which is proved by the scientist Foucault rotating mirror method. That means this third phenomenon, velocity of light in rarer medium is greater than velocity of light in denser medium, will be experimentally proved in the another experiments also. So these are the two important parameters about the Huygens wave theory. Huygens wave theory. Next one, what are the limitations as well as the explanation about the Huygens theory? Clearly, I can explain. Huygens wave theory can successfully explain the concept of rectilinear propagation of light. Second one, reflection of light. Third one, refraction of light. Fourth one, interference of light. Fifth one, diffraction of light. Sixth one, polarization of light. All these five or six characteristics of the light can be explained according to Huygens theory. But, polarization not. These five parameters only, up to diffraction, the light, these properties can be explained according to Huygens theory. But Huygens theory cannot explain the concept of polarization of light. Polarization of light property, it is not explained using Huygens theory. Right, right. So the next one is, what is meant by Huygens principle? Huygens. Huygens principle. Huygens principle. Huygens principle. So before we explain the Huygens principle, what is meant by a wave front? What is a wave front? Suppose it is a point source. First property is, what is a wave front? Suppose it is a point source. Yes. This source can emit the light in all directions. One wave is traveling maybe along this direction, and this is the direction of propagation of the wave in the another direction. Is the direction of propagation of the wave in the remaining directions? Right. So the source can send the light waves in all directions of 360 degrees around it. In general, as the light is coming out of the source, the displacement of the particle can be expressed as y is equal to a into sin omega t plus kx. A into sin omega t plus kx. Here, y is equal to displacement of the particle, x is equal to displacement of the wave, a is equal to amplitude of the wave. This omega t plus kx indicates the total phase of the oscillating wave. Omega t plus kx is equal to phase. Suppose ikkada manaki in a time t is equal to 0, t is equal to 0, the waves are ready to spread from the source. Now, after a time t is equal to t1 seconds, after a time t is equal to t1 seconds, the wave coming in this direction will travel in a time of t1 seconds. It is moving from this point to this point. It is the point A. Displacement traveled by the wave is equal to x. That's why at the point A, the phase of the particle can be represented by omega t1 plus kx. Similarly, in the same time, this wave is moving like this. Here B is any point. Displacement of the wave traveled from 0 to t is equal to t1 seconds. So therefore, phase of this vibrating particle is also equal to omega t1 plus kx. Because in the same time, wave travels through the same distance in all the other all directions. Suppose it is the C also. It is D also. Means, phase of the particle C is also equal to omega t1 plus kx. Phase of the particle D is also equal to omega t1 plus kx. That means all these four particles have the same phase at a time t is equal to t1 seconds. So A, B, C, D. These are all having same phase. Now let us join all these four points around the given source. Therefore, this is the locus which joins all the particles at the same phase. So, the locus which joins all the particles in the same phase is known as the wave front. That is the definition for a wave front. Are you understand? So, what is meant by a wave front? The locus which joining all the points around the source which are in the same phase is known as the locus, is known as the wavefront. So this is the wavefront corresponding to the source, yes, at a time t is equal to t1 seconds. Again, after a time t is equal to t2 seconds, also t2 greater than t1, this wave is traveling through a displacement here, and this is the another point, it is another point, and this is the another point. Again, these points are also having the same phase. Now let us draw a locus by joining all these points. This is also called as the wave front after another time t is equal to t1 seconds. Are you understand? So then what is the definition for wave front? Wave front is nothing but the locus joining all the points around the source which are in the same phase. Now what is the phase difference between any two points on the wave front? This A and B both are in the same phase. Phase difference between A and B is equal to zero. But there should be a phase difference between any two points on different wave fronts. It is one wave front, this is another wave front. Here S is the source, means point wise source, which is in the form of a sphere. Means it is the three dimensional concept. Around the given source, this is also in the form of a sphere. That means the wave front corresponding to a point source is always spherical in nature. It is the first spherical wave front, second spherical wave front, and so on. So that means from this experiment, we conclude that a point source which is always produce a spherical wave front. Spherical wave front. So next one, let the same point wave source is kept at infinite distance from the given position. Point source is kept at infinite distance. Means the light rays coming from the source, which are approximately, they are parallel. Parallel to optic axis. These are the light rays coming from the point source. This point source which is kept at infinite distance. From S2, after a time t is equal to some 100 seconds or 200 seconds, let the distance travelled by the first wave is equal to, say it is, distance travelled by the second wave is also equal to this. Now let us join all these points by a locus which is called as the wave front. So this wave front is called as the plane wave front. It is plane wave front. But which source produces a plane wave front? A point wise source kept at infinite distance, that will produce a plane wave front. Point wise source kept at finite distance, they produce always spherical wave fronts. Next one, suppose you could observe cheyandi, the light rays coming from the source, yes, the light rays, this is the light ray coming from the source, and this is also light ray coming from the source. It is the light ray coming from the source. By observing this, all these light rays are always perpendicular to wave front. Got it? Compulsory direction of propagation of the wave or direction of propagation of light is always perpendicular to the wave front. Here also, this is the light direction. Direction of propagation of the light should be perpendicular to this plane. This is the plane. This is the plane like this. Therefore, the plane which is perpendicular to light propagation, which are equidistant, all the points on the given plane which are equidistant from the source,